Hello there, and welcome to your first at-home lecture for AP Psychology. So we talked about how to take notes in class, but I want you to stop and remember those steps. So you're setting up your paper, you're making sure that you have your heading done, you're making sure that you're in a place where you have some time to listen to a lecture. Now, there's a couple ways you can do this. You can either listen to the entire thing first to kind of get a feel about what the lecture is going to be about, or you can write while you listen, but make sure you're not doing two things at the same time. Talk about multitasking and trying to divide your brain. I know sometimes you don't have a whole lot of time to listen to the lecture two or three times, but if you're only able to get some things written down the first time, make sure you listen to it again to really get the understanding of it. There'll be some things that I say that are not written down. There'll be some things that are written down that I didn't say. So in class, we'll work on putting those two things together. For now, I want you to get the general information down on a paper so that you can study it, but then also be listening to it to really make sense of the content. So we're going to start with what is psychology. So we kind of start the year with looking at psychology as a history class. Throughout the year, that changes. So there's some units that are very much scientific, biology-based, like parts of the brain and neurotransmitters. And then there's some units that are more historical point of views or social point of views and kind of the combination of all three. So let's talk about talking about how psychology has changed over time, the history of psychology. Just a refresher from class, this is up on the board, but the definition of psychology is the science of behavior. So behavior is anything that we can actually observe, so what we do, and the mental processes that go with it. So mental processes are things that you can't, I want you to think about, those are things that you can't see, right? So your sensations, your perceptions, your dreams, your thoughts, beliefs, feelings, things inside your brain that aren't visible. They may manifest themselves as being visible, so your feelings could be a behavior as well, but we treat those things separately, right? So the science of behavior and mental processes. Science meaning that the current day definition of psychology, we're looking at scientific processes that look at these two things, behavior and mental processes. Current psychology is very much a science. We'll learn about the scientific method, that you'll have to do some data statistical analysis of studies, but that's not how it always was. So psychology used to be more philosophical. These days it's more scientific. So let's look at the roots of psychology. So psychology roots, we're going to talk about pre-scientific psychology, before there was that scientific method behind it. There's a lot of names you'll need to know for this lecture. Hold on, let me fix this a little bit. There's going to be some dates you are not super important, but you do need to know names and then who they're associated with. Okay, so we're going to first start out with some ancient philosophers looking at this question. It's not a new type of thought or idea to look at how the mind and the body are connected. All right, so ancient Greeks, in India, and Buddha thought, how are these two things connected? So there was different divergent trains of thought for psychology. So the first question to address, how is the mind related to the body? There's a group of people or philosophers that thought that the mind and the body are connected, meaning that the mind dies with the body, if that makes sense. Okay, so you have these two things that are together. The Hebrews, Aristotle and Augustine are people that the mind and the body are connected. And then there is a second group of people along the thought that the mind and the body are distinct, meaning that the mind exists outside of the body. Socrates, Plato, Descartes, again, these are philosophers. These are people that thought that they were separate, that the mind could exist outside of the body, right? Think of more of like a soul, if you want to think of it like that, that it goes on or it exists outside of the body. Okay, similar groups of people, look at this next chart, or we looked at how ideas are formed. So looking at the mind and body and how ideas are formed. And we'll talk about nature versus nurture a lot during class. And so what we're looking for on that, some ideas are inborn. This would be that you are born with all of the things that are already in your mind, right? That throughout your growth or development, that you already have these things within you, that they just come out at different times. All right, so that would be a nature point of view. You're born with everything that makes you who you are. So Socrates and Plato were of that mindset. Some ideas are born. The mind is a blank slate would be Aristotle and Locke, and that was that your environment determines everything about who you are, that you're not born with any ideas in your mind, that your environment kind of determines who you are. That's going to be our nurture point of view. So this is going to be my nature, this is going to be my nurture. All right. So those are our pre-scientific psychology. So let's talk about when psychology actually did become a science. So this was philosophy. Now let's move into more scientific. You need to know the father of psychology was William Wundt. And William Wundt was a German scientist. He's considered the father of psychology. And he started psychology under the idea of structuralism and empiricism, meaning that empirical evidence, you had to have a study that went with the hypothesis or the thought. Okay, so it's the first formal lab that was established towards the end of the 1800s in Germany. He wanted to look at the consciousness and how the mind was organized and what that related to the body. Right, so if you look at this word structure, he was a structuralist, meaning that he's looking at the elements of the mind being organized, how things were structured in the mind. He used a psychological, a technique, could not think of that word, tip of the tongue, technique called introspection. And introspection we'll talk about more with Freud, but introspection was looking into the mind and doing free association. What is the first thing that comes to your mind when you move your arm, and looking more introspection of people's thoughts and how it's connected to the body. So he's considered the father of psychology. There's another William that we're going to learn about here in just a second. So William Wundt was a German psychologist. Okay, he was our father of psychology. His like protege, his son of the father was William James. And William James was the first psychologist in America. So we'll talk about some mnemonic devices or things so you can remember this. But James, think about like Jamestown, right? So Jamestown was America being started. So think about William James was a son of William Wundt, right? So he was looked at him as like his protege, or he studied from him, but he was in America, and he rejected the structuralism of Wundt, and he was of the mindset of functionalism, right? So it doesn't matter how the mind and body are structured, it matters how it functions within the environment. Okay, so you can think about functionalism as how a person or people function within their environment. Structuralism is looking at how they're actually put together. Now, William James was heavily influenced by Darwin. I want you to go back to biology. Darwin was my natural selection. He's the one that said traits that are beneficial for the animal or the human will be passed on. The traits that are not beneficial will die off. So James looked at psychology that way too, the way that people act and their behaviors, the ones that allow us to survive and reproduce will go on, and the ones that are bad for our reproduction or functioning in society will die off. Okay, this is very different from structuralism. He's looking at functionalism and how he functioned within the environment. Okay, so James, about the same time, right? So he studied from Wundt and looked at his ideas, but was in America. Someone that he worked with, Mary Calkins, sometimes I've seen her name on AP test, but you should know that she worked with James. They're usually mentioned in conjunction or together, and it's usually talked about what type of psychology that they study. Okay, so William James in functionalism, these things I just said, first American psychologist, too narrow, influenced by Darwin. He also used introspection here, but he also used things like mental tests and questionnaires. So it wasn't all about people's thoughts and looking at their feelings. He also looked at some more empirical data, looking at scientific data, questionnaires, and mental tests. Okay, now Gestalt psychology. Now we're going to kind of go off and not from necessarily, dates, but we're going to look at types of psychology. So Gestalt was someone, we'll talk about him so much in sensation and perception, but his also went against the original founders of psychology, against Wundt and his ideas. He thought that the consciousness was best understood by looking at the entire experience. So Gestalt psychology really asks us to look at the person as a whole versus the portions of them. Okay, so instead of looking at a person by subdivisions and saying that all adds up to a person, we look at the person and then take that as it's bigger than the sum of its parts. Okay, so his catchphrase, the whole is different than the sum of its parts. And we really will look at that in sensation and perception. So just remember Gestalt as being more holistic for now. And when we look at how we see things and hear things and taste things, we'll talk about how the whole is different from the sum of its parts. Okay. Now, psychoanalysis, so another type of psychology, psychoanalysis. Psychoanalysis is a little bit modern. We'll talk about how it changed into psychodynamic, but this is going to be our just poster child of psychology. Sigmund Freud was a psychoanalysis or psychoanalytical therapist. So Sigmund Freud is the person you see here. He is like the, probably the person that you've seen acted or portrayed as a psychologist. He had the accent. It was all about these suppressed feelings and things that you weren't even aware of, and that really influenced who you are. Okay, so he believed that all these forces were always the impetus or the reason why we did certain things. Okay, and all the problems that you have in your life would arise from these unresolved issues. We learn about him a lot more when we talk about personality, because he had some really interesting thoughts on different types of personality and these stages that we go through. So for instance, Freud thought that the first developmental stage that you go through, you have to have this, there's like something called the anal stage, right? And during the anal stage is when you're potty training. So it goes up to about age 3. And during the anal stage, you have to learn control of your bodily functions. It's and if you master that stage, if you feel competent, then you go on. So what Freud would say is, if you had some problems potty training, if you were never able to really control the environment around you, your body, that you might be stuck in that stage for the rest of your life. And even though you're not aware of it, it would be the reason why you have problems controlling things later in life. Really odd and very different. But because he focused so much on that abnormal psychology, it brought so much attention and so much publicity to psychology, because his ideas were controversial, they were interesting, and people like the abnormal psych. Right? It might be a reason you're taking this class. People like the weird type of disorders and multiple personalities. It's interesting. And he brought a lot of light to the field of psychology. So even though his techniques of psychoanalysis, psychodynamic, aren't used as much today solely, some people use them like an eclectic approach, so they use a little bit of everything. He's kind of like considered the first person that kind of brought psychology to the spotlight. Okay, his ideas, it says at the bottom there, are still controversial, but they've had great influence on the field. Okay, so now let's talk about psychology as a science. So this psychoanalysis is very much not a science, right? There's nothing that you can, he used a lot of, I skipped over it, free association, looking at like, what's the first thing you think of when you, you know, look at a baseball hat. And it was just like the person talking on the couch. The psychologist never faced the patient. The patient just kind of talked freely and looked a lot at the unconscious mind. So this is in total contrast to the two people we're going to talk about next, which is psychology as a science and behavioralism. So it's very modern psychology. It was very popular in the early 20s to 60s. And these people, so we'll talk about Watson and Skinner, disagreed with practically everyone that came before them. Watson and Skinner said there's no such thing as this unconscious. There's no such thing as a mind that we're not aware of. Everything in psychology should be based off of what we can see, behavioral. These are behavioralists. We'll talk about Watson and Skinner for learning. But they believe that anything that we cannot measure should not even be a part of psychology. If I can't watch someone do this or watch someone get better or worse, then it shouldn't even be part of psychology, because it's not a science. Okay, so these people believed, going back to ancient Greek, these are part of people that would say that everything, the mind is a blank slate, that the environment determines everything. We are not born with anything that makes us who we are. It is all this external factors that make a person who they are. Okay, so the hidden parts of the mind, not relevant. Watson and Skinner, know their names for now, and again, we'll talk about them more in class. So contemporary psychology, going back to the definition at the beginning, is really, so what is psychology then? If we're looking at the science behind behavior and our mental processes, it's not this one type of approach. So we talked about psychoanalysis, behavioralism, empirical, structuralism, functionalism, and we'll talk about more. It's usually this blend of everything. So that's a word I've used before, I'll use it again, an eclectic, meaning that there's a little bit of everything when we look at psychology, and that's exactly how this class is based. We'll look at a little bit of everything. One of the big things, again, we'll talk about, it's early in your notes, but here it is written, the nature versus nurture. We'll look at this in class, and you will have to be able to tell on an AP test or during writing an idea of whether or not it's a nature or nurture versus idea. So again, remember, nature is our biology, everything that's born with, you're born with these certain traits, nurture is your environment. Okay, and really that goes back and looks at like the cause of every single thing. So if we say that you are born with, I have here like multiple personalities or anxiety, when we look at nature versus nurture, we say, okay, if you're an anxious person, someone who is of the nature point of view thinks that you were born with that, or it's in your genes, right? Genetics, that's why you are anxious. A person who is of the nurture point of view would say that you have anxiety because of your environment. And if you can change the things in your environment, you can control your anxiety. Okay, we'll look at other things like intelligence, abnormal psychology, things like that. And I'm going to end today's lecture by talking about the biopsychosocial approach to psychology. You will see this chart, I don't know, after every single lecture, because in a part of your book, we'll look at your book tomorrow. They look at like a certain concept, and they approach it from a biological point of view, from a psychological point of view, and a social cultural. All right, so you need to know this one. Sometimes I have you write these down, sometimes I don't. That's another good reason to listen to me. A lot of times I'll say, write this down or don't write this down. We'll look at this in class. But here's something that you need to know. So we always take that concept in the middle and then we approach it from a biological point of view first. So if I'm looking at a mental process, approaching it from a biological influence, I'd be looking at genetics, mutations, natural selection, Darwinism type things, genes responding to the environment. Same concept, now let's look at it psychological and look at thoughts, learned fears and behaviors, emotions, cognitive processes. So cognitive is thinking. So think thinking when you think cognitive. And then social cultural influences. How does your culture, the people that you surround yourself or the beliefs that you grew up with influence your behavior? That could be the presence of others. It could be your culture, your peers, your parents, models such as the media approaching it. Okay, in class, we're going to look at some more perspectives and have you guys look at a chart from your book, but that's going to be it for today. Make sure you go back through your notes, listen to the game, pause them, re-listen, make sure you have all these little things filled in, because in class, we have conversations about these notes, so you really need to have a good understanding of what was in the lecture the night before. All right, another thing to bring into class, any questions you have. Okay, if I talk too fast, if you miss something, write it down, and it's a good conversation starter for the next day. Have a great night.